Let's continue with numerical methods. So we have completed the section on random number generation. And so in the last session, when we have completed this, I discussed the weighted Monte Carlo method. So coming from acceptance rejection, we saw that if we do the acceptance rejection sampling to generate a sequence, we can just reinterpret it, or we can just improve it a little bit by not throwing points away and instead just taking a weight in the Monte Carlo integral. So it means that we have come back to where we started. Yeah. So our Monte Carlo method. So the generation of the random number sequences was to here support our Monte Carlo method, generate here the drawing. So in this formulation, Xi is a sequence of iid random variables, and from that I take one event, so generate the drawing little Xi. And in the next chapter, so what we will do after this session, I would like to discuss stochastic processes. So stochastic processes are just families of random variables that are parameterized with a time parameter. And this will be the foundation of all the models which we look at. So in mathematical finance, for example, the Black-Scholes model. I have the Black-Scholes model as an example in this session in a few slides. So now I would like to have a short look what it means to apply a Monte Carlo method to a time discrete stochastic process. So I would like to discuss the Monte Carlo simulation. So now I use the word simulation. So actually it's to some extent also a Monte Carlo integration of an expectation of a function that is derived from realization of a stochastic process. Well, in this section, it's say time discrete stochastic process. So a time discrete stochastic process is a family of random variables. For example, S, so and I now use S for a stock, because it is like in the Black-Scholes model, that is parameterized by time. Motivation is our application where we like to calculate the value, the fair value of a financial derivative. Well, you remember maybe the universal pricing theorem, so which tells you that you can express the fair value, actually the replication cost, for that financial derivative by taking the expectation of the future value. So in case the value is just given by a payoff, so something that's paid, well, not exactly the future value. The future value divided by the numerator is a martingale. So you have to multiply with the ratio of the numerator at payment time and evaluation time. So that is here this N. But apart from that, it's the expectation of a random variable. And if you now think of our application, we had this already, that this random variable V, the future payoff, is a function of S. So we had this motivation in a previous session where S is, for example, the value of a stock. So if you have time now in mind, here I have the time axis T. Here is little t, the point where I start. And I would like to value this random variable. So now let's call this capital T. So, and then the axis is just say time, just write time here. I would like to calculate here the expectation of a function that depends on something that has happened here. So if you include this stuff with the numerator, I would multiply here with N of T divided by N of T, But anyway, the randomness is in capital T. Well, there are also options that depend on what happened in the past. For example, an Asian option. So if you look at an Asian option, this is just a motivation, yeah, here in mathematical finance, it will pay you something in capital T. Yeah? So it depends on this future point, capital T. But what it pays is the average that you have observed on previous points. So it pays you here an average over S of Ti, where Ti is some time discretization. So we look here at T1, T2, T3, and so on. And there's here, for example, Tn, and maybe Tn is the capital T. So we look what has happened to the stock when we start here. Yeah? So the stock was there, 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 and so on. So that was a little bit where he moved. And you see that it's actually a function of a family of random variables. So here, S of T1 up to Tn is a family of random variables parameterized by time. And maybe I had this remark before when I was motivating that Monte Carlo method is suitable for high dimensions and that dimensions can become very high. We can have 100 dimensions because now you see that here again. This is a vector valued random variable x. So this corresponds to a vector-valued random variable x in n dimensions. And n is now just the number of time steps. So if you have, for example, an Asian option that pays you the average of the value of the stock for the last year, averaged over all values that have been attained at the end of the week, so there are 52 weeks, so I'm averaging 52 different random variables because each event was random at each week. So I have 52 dimensions. So calculating this expectation from the previous slide is an integral, is an expectation over 52 dimensions. So we are high dimensional. When I have this time parameterized family, sometimes I can look at the vector as a single random variable. And then if I apply omega, it is one event of this vector. And this guy is then called the path. So for fixed omega, I see that I have here a sequence of values. I can reinterpret this sequence of values as the vector-valued random variable evaluated at a single omega. So that here is now my single omega. Yeah, so that is a path. So for a time-discrete stochastic process, my Monte Carlo simulation is like sampling a vector in high dimensions. So I use the term Monte Carlo simulation, yeah, so the word simulation, often when I'm in this situation, so like a Monte Carlo sampling of a stochastic process, but which you can reinterpret as this vector in high dimension. Yeah? So it's just a special version of a high dimensional Monte Carlo integration. So here remark 39 is just the summary that we have this vector in high dimension. So I can interpret this as an n-dimensional vector here. Of course, an example is just the Black-Scholes model. So let's have a look at this. Well, the Black-Scholes model is not a time-discrete stochastic process. So the stochastic process would look like this, ds, so the infinitesimal change of the stock is mu s dt, so is proportional to the current value of the stock with a fixed rate mu. So maybe mu is then the interest rate, or here it's just the drift of the log normal process, plus sigma s dw. Okay, but then you can write the solution of this. So if you have an initial value, say here s of t zero is an initial value s zero, you can write the solution for any future point in time. So s is this log normal process. So the logarithm of s is a normal process. So you have with Itô's lemma that the logarithm of s is mu, and then this here comes from Itô's lemma, minus 1/2 sigma squared. Yeah, and if you take the logarithm, the derivative of the logarithm is the derivative of s divided by s. So actually the s vanishes. The minus 1/2 sigma squared comes from the second order term, dw dw is dt. So I have here no s. Yeah. So taking the logarithm, the s vanishes. I have this guy. And then I have here sigma dw. So now you know that this here is normal distributed. If you integrate over in fixed size interval. So if I integrate this guy here from ti to ti plus one over dt, well, the first guy is just a fixed interval, a constant integrated over a fixed interval. So this is just mu times sigma squared ti plus one minus ti. And the second one is just sigma times w ti plus one minus w ti. And this is the Brownian motion. So this is normal distributed with mean zero and standard deviation square root of the time step. Okay, so take this just as given, but you see that I can then derive here this nice representation that tells me the next value is a function of a previous value. So below I wrote down the integral over the logarithm. So this means the logarithm at the next value minus the logarithm at the previous value is the stuff on the right hand side. If you take the exponential, it means the next value is equal to the previous value multiplied with the exponential of the stuff on the right-hand side. So multiplied with the exponential of some constant mu minus 1/2 sigma squared multiplied with the time step plus sigma square root of time step multiplied with a random variable that is standard normal. Yeah? So IID standard normal random variables. So you immediately see that here the sequence of possible realizations for the stock is generated from a vector of IID standard normals So, yeah, so a vector where each component is a standard normal random variable and all the components are independent. Okay, so you see that our Monte Carlo method immediately applies to time discrete stochastic processes. So here I'm looking at time discrete stochastic processes. By just reinterpreting the sequence over time as the elements of this vector. So the number of time steps relates to the dimension of the Monte Carlo integral. So it is a Monte Carlo integral over this vector here. Okay, and that's it, yeah? So apart from that, there's no additional step when we move from Monte Carlo method applied for a vector valued random variable to Monte Carlo method applied to a time discrete stochastic process. So with this little remark, yeah, so this is just a very tiny, tiny chapter. I have already discussed Monte Carlo simulation, so Monte Carlo method for stochastic processes. It's just every time step is one component of a vector, and therefore it can be high dimensional. So what is actually left is that I need to explain a little bit this stuff here. How do we get from a stochastic process in continuous time? So this here is a stochastic process in continuous time to a stochastic process in discrete time. And that's the time discretization of stochastic processes, which is the next chapter, which is also a numerical method, Euler scheme, Milstein scheme, different discretization schemes, how we discretize the stochastic process. So to conclude this session, I would like to mention one other example of a Monte Carlo simulation of a stochastic process, because this example is also relevant in applications, yeah, so not only in mathematical finance. And from the way it is done, it's a little bit different. I already had these different examples because I already discussed the exponential distribution, and I was motivating it as a random time, so a time when something happens. Yeah. So we were sampling times when an event happening every omega, every sample was giving us a different time. And I already mentioned that you can think of that this event or this experiment is repeated. So you ask yourself, okay, what happens once this has happened? What happens if I then repeat the experiment? How long does it take for the next one? And you have the experiment again, and you could interpret the parameter lambda for the exponential distribution. So if I have an exponential distribution with parameter lambda, intensity lambda, you can interpret this lambda as somehow the frequency with which the event happens. When I think about this, now I have again time in my mind. I have a stochastic process. And I can now define the stochastic process, which is called the Poisson process, that does not give me the time when something happens. It just counts how many events have happened before. So I assume that here Ti minus one is an exponential distributed random variable with intensity lambda. And I just count how many events have happened before time little t. So this here is how many events have happened before little t. Okay, let's draw a little picture. How does this look like? So t zero is zero. So I start here in zero. Okay. Then I have T1. And now it is that T1 up to T1 minus T0 is an exponential distributed random variable. So this here is actually a random time. So this is a random. So this may be now a bit confusing. Yeah, this is a random time step. So it may happen that this time step is here. Yeah, so we sample the random time. Then it means that n of little t is zero up to this point here. And then we count here the indicator function. So if little t is larger than t1, the indicator is 1 and I have a 1. So here I have a 1, a 2, a 3. So, and then I draw another random time step, the random time step from T1 to T2. It may be this guy here is now T2. And I count another event. So it looks a little bit like that. This looks on a path, yeah? Say on omega 1. So, but now the time steps are random. So maybe on a different time step, it looks on a different omega, it looks different. Okay, so this green point here is now T1, T2. So this here is T2. So the time after two events. So how long it took that two events had happened on path, say, omega 2. So we have that Ti is equal to the sum j from 0 to I minus 1, Tj plus 1 minus Tj. And this is the random time at which I events have happened. Okay, and in between, the stochastic process n is just constant, yeah? So we have here different such guys, yeah? Okay, it can also jump up to 3 very quickly, yeah? And then we have another path, omega 3. Well, this is a fairly different way of creating a stochastic process, yeah? So previously, it was that we have some fixed time steps and we are generating the values of the stochastic process. Yeah? So go back to our Black-Scholes example. So in our Black-Scholes example, I started here with a fixed time discretization. And then I had some rule that was generating out of random drawings, random values at these fixed time steps. For the Poisson process, the difference, the way to construct it is inverted. I have fixed values, 1, 2, 3, and I'm creating the times at which the value is attained. Okay, so in the construction of this stochastic process, well, the code looks a little bit different, but we already mentioned that we have, for example, with an exponential distribution here with a fixed parameter lambda, we have a very nice way of creating these times. Yeah? Of course, if you would like to create this up to a fixed time horizon. So assume you have here some fixed time horizon. I have here some, say, can I use capital T? Yeah, I can use capital T. Then it may be that for some omegas, I have to sample more intervals, yeah, and I will reach higher values than for others. Okay, that's also a stochastic process, and we can create it using our Monte Carlo method. There's also an inhomogeneous version of this. We had already the inhomogeneous exponential distribution, which means that the intensity for the time intervals in the future changes. A nice little thing, actually I could also reformulate this maybe as a lemma, is that you can just reinterpret this as a scaling of time. So if you have a stochastic process that is a Poisson process with intensity one, then if you plug in a reparametrization of the time according to this rule here, lambda of little t is the integral of lambda s ds up to time t. So if you differentiate lambda little t with respect to little t, it means lambda d lambda by dt. This is just little lambda of t. So little lambda of t is the speed, is the velocity by which I change this time. Okay, so if I use this, so I have here some velocity by which I change the time, I can just construct the inhomogeneous one by plugging in this lambda, the reparametrization of time, into the time parameter of the y. So I plug this in here and I get then my x. So this is an inhomogeneous process. So since we can generate a Poisson process with intensity one, we can also generate the other one. It just changes the times. Okay, so here you have a small remark on this. Also what I just said, that the spirit of building the stochastic process is different. For the Black-Scholes model, we had a fixed time discretization. Okay, and we generated different values. And here it is different. We have, say, fixed values, and we are somehow generating the times at which the stuff is happening. A small remark. Lambda is this frequency parameter. So it is the expectation, the expected frequency at which events occur. So a frequency is something like 1/s in the unit. So if you multiply lambda with time, it is the expected amount of events up to time t. So, and if you subtract lambda times t from this process n of t, then this guy is a martingale. So in expectation, there is no change. So expectation of m of capital T is m of little t. So if you started with already five events, then in expectation, or if you started already with m equals five, so the expectation of a future m is also just five. So minus lambda t is correcting this in expectation. So this guy here is sometimes then called the compensator. Okay, because it compensates the discrete jumps. So such that you get in expectation this value. If you draw this, it would look a little bit like this. So you go here with some intensity lambda, you go down, and then you jump up and you go down again, and the slope here is just a lambda and you jump up. Sometimes you jump up more. Okay, so it looks like that. And the same with another path. Okay, so you go down here, then it can happen that you jump up more. Okay, and you go down here, and the stuff where you go down is always the linear lambda t, and the other one is just the counting. Okay, and that's then the process m. So that would be here m of little t and a fixed omega. Okay, so that was it. Just to conclude, Monte Carlo simulation of stochastic processes, time discrete stochastic processes, is like a high dimensional random variable, integration of a high dimensional or sampling of a high dimensional random variable. And you have to be careful with low discrepancy sequences. Okay. So note that you cannot use the rule, I have a single sequence and I just populate every element of the vector. So you cannot go through Black-Scholes model and just draw a random number from a low discrepancy sequence and use it for the increment. You cannot use this because you are in a high dimensional space. Every time step is an independent dimension. So you have to use a multidimensional low discrepancy sequence. So to generate a quasi Monte Carlo method, so a low discrepancy sequences for a Monte Carlo simulation of a stochastic process that has 100 time steps, every time step generated by an independent uniform drawing, you have to use a 100 dimensional low discrepancy sequence. So 100 dimensions for the Holton sequence. So be careful with this. Maybe we can have an example where I do it, where I do the mistake and do Black-Scholes with the low discrepancy sequence in one dimension, and you can see that the result is completely wrong. That was it for today and this session. So the next question that we are now left with is, how do I generate a time discrete stochastic process given that I have a time continuous stochastic process? And that will be our next chapter, and will be some more new numerical methods that will come up. Thanks.